ready, guys. Tonight's special guest speaker, Dr. Stephen Kajura, is a professor in the Biological Sciences Department at Florida Atlantic University. Dr. Kajura is an expert in shark biology and behavior. He holds a master's degree from Florida Institute of Technology and a PhD from the University of Hawaii. Dr. Kajura has conducted research for various agencies, including the National Science Foundation, the Department of Defense, and the National Marine Fisheries Service. He's published more than 50 peer-reviewed scientific papers, and he's been featured on a number of local media news outlets as well as nationally televised documentaries. He also holds the distinction of being my only lecture series guest to fly into Stuart for his appearance. So thank you for flying in. Tonight, Dr. Kajura is going to tell us about some of the research that he's been conducting over the last decade focused on the enormous schools of migratory black-tipped sharks that show up in our area every winter. It is with great pleasure that I introduce to you Dr. Stephen Kajura.
All right. How do you guys hear me? Can you hear me okay at the back? Are we good? Yeah? Okay, fantastic. Now, this just woke up. Let's see if it pops up on screen. 1 second. Da-da-da-da. Look at that. All right. We seem to be working. Thank you, guys, and thank you, Dr. Zach, for the introduction and the invitation to come and talk to you guys today about some of the work that we've been doing. As he mentioned, for the past decade or so, I've been looking at these aggregations of large black-tipped sharks that occur right here off South Florida. Now, how many of you are familiar with these? How many of you have seen sharks in the news or on TV, something? Yeah, so you're basically familiar with them. And so what happened was, I was this professor down at Florida Atlantic University, shark guy doing shark stuff, and what would happen is I would get calls from the local television station saying that their, whoops, my mic fell off, their news helicopters had seen a bunch of sharks off the beach. Should we be concerned? What's going on? What's happening? And they would see sharks all over the place, and there's people right on the beach with all the sharks. And they would want to know, hey, should we be concerned with, should we tell the people what's happening? Our helicopters keep seeing all of this stuff. And you can walk along the beach like this and see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, a dozen sharks right in frame. And some people would actually have sharks right literally in their backyard. Some of these houses would have a bunch of sharks. Now, if it were me, I would love to live in one of these houses and have sharks in their backyard. Some of these people were not quite as impressed. And so it started this question, what's happening? What's going on? And so I would get calls from the TV stations and I would say, well, it's this migration. The sharks come down here every winter. The locals know about it. You guys have all heard about it. Don't worry about it. You asked me the same question last year. I told you the same thing. They keep coming down every year. But what I found is that there's surprisingly little information in the scientific literature documenting this phenomenon. We know about it as people in South Florida, but the rest of the world was largely unaware. And so it gave me a great opportunity to actually study these sharks in the sky. And I determined that, it's these news helicopters that get all this dramatic footage. Maybe what I should do is get in the air and start looking at the sharks from up above. And that's what sort of brought this together. As Dr. Zach mentioned, I'm a pilot. I've been flying since before this, actually. But it was a great opportunity for me to combine my interest in flying with my interest in sharks and actually sort of bring it all together. And so that's what was the impetus for this study a decade ago now. And so when you see these sharks cruising along the beach, these are all black-tipped sharks. Black-tipped sharks are a typical sort of shark that we see around here. They're about the same size as me from the feet to the head. They're averaging about 5'8 to 5'10, and I'm 5'9, so it's right in that range. And what they're doing is they're swimming down here. They're spending the winters here for a couple of months, and then they head north, and they go back up north again in the springtime. And so what we did was we mounted a camera, a high-definition video camera, out the window of a Cessna 172. And I flew a transect along the coast. Now, when I initially started this project, we just flew from Boca Raton up to Jupiter, just covering Palm Beach County. But subsequently to that, we got additional funding, so we're able to do an even longer survey. And now we go all the way from South Beach, Miami, up to Jupiter. So now we're covering the whole coast. And that should say to 2020. I need to update that slide clearly. And so we fly along the beach with the camera mounted out the window of the plane. It's filming constantly as we're flying along. And this is sort of what the camera is seeing. You have the plane flying out of the screen towards you. There's the beach with the umbrella. There's the water with all the sharks. And the camera has this field of view looking down like this, so it sees from the beach where the people are to about 200 meters offshore. Think of this as one football field, two football fields offshore, all right? So it's not very far. And we deliberately hug the beach because that's where the people are. I mean, that's kind of the whole point of this. And we're counting the numbers of sharks that we see close to the beach here. Now, we know there's more, but, you know, you can only it's an ocean out here. You can only do so much, you know? So you have to, limit it to a certain extent. But the nice thing is the water is pretty shallow, and it's a nice, light, sandy bottom. It's one of the attractions down here in South Florida is we have beautiful beaches with beautiful sand. And as a result, you can see these dark silhouettes of the sharks clearly through the water, through the shallow water, against the sandy bottom. And so when you're flying along, this is sort of what you're seeing. All right? There's the beach. There's the wheel. There's the strut of the plane. Every one of those black dots is a shark. Now, we're flying along at, 60, 70 knots, so you've got about 2 seconds. How many sharks are there? Go. One, two. Oh, you didn't count them in fast enough. Anyone want to take a guess?
10,000.
10,000? 250? What else? More than one. That's the best answer. Greater than one and less than 10,000. Anyone else? 25? A million? There's 1,678 dots on the screen right there. Now, that just gives you an idea of what one of these aggregations looks like. I'm going to give you the video clip from which this was taken. I'm just going to show you a 30-second clip, all right, just to show you the context for this. And this was when I first started the survey back in 2011. And as you're flying along, there's the beach, right? And you can see the sharks. See all the sharks popping up along here? All right. And it just keeps going. There's sharks. And as you fly along, you continue to see them. And you can tell there's obviously no way you can count this in real time. Look at this aggregation. That's thousands, right? There's no way you could do that. And that's why we have to video record it and go back and take the video to the lab where we're able to go more slowly and count, how many sharks are there along the length here. Now, one of the other things I want to point out is not only are there lots of sharks, and this is just 30 seconds out of the whole transect, right? But recognize, right on the far left of the screen, there's the road. There's A1A. You can drive down the road right there and toss a rock and hit a shark. I mean, they're that close to the beach, all right? And so what we're able to do is take this video footage back to the lab, like I said. We download it on the computer. We're able to scroll through the video more slowly to make sure that we're counting all the sharks on the screen. Actually, the students do the counting. I'm not an idiot. Get the students to count the sharks on the screen, and we actually get some really good data from this. We're able to look at this over time, and I want to point out that this is going from 2011 to 2018. Whoops, oh darn, I didn't update this slide to 2019. And this is the number of sharks. And so you can see that in the winter time, January, February, March, huge numbers of sharks, and it drops off to hardly anything throughout the rest of the year. Then in the wintertime, again, huge numbers of sharks, and it keeps dropping off. All right, so up and down. Eventually, we just stopped counting in the summer times because there were hardly any sharks there. Now, this year was anomalous, 2013, and that was because there was a lot of this beach renourishment. You're familiar with this, where they pump the sand offshore onto the beach, to make the beach bigger like this. But what it does is it sets up these enormous silt clouds where you simply can't see anything. And so there might be sharks there and we can't see them, or more likely the sharks have, scooted offshore a little bit to get out of the way of this. And so as you're flying along the beach here, we're seeing nothing, and so that's why the numbers were particularly low that year. That was one anomalous year. But it did bounce back again the next year back up to where it was. Now, we're going to come to this decline in just a minute. But what I want to talk about is where we're looking at these animals. Remember I said we're flying from Miami up to Jupiter, when we initially started just Boca up to Jupiter? Well, what we're able to do is we break this whole transect down into segments. And there are nice little inlets all along the coast here that enable us to segment the whole thing. So we're able to count the number of sharks between, Government Cut and Haulover Inlet, or between Haulover and Port Everglades, etc. And because we know the distances between them, we know that, Palm Beach to Jupiter Inlet is 19.3 kilometers, and we remember that video transect is about from the shore to about 200 meters offshore, right? So you know the width and you know the length. Therefore, you can get the area, right? The transect width is 200 meters, and so we're able to say, all right, so the area that we sampled here is 3.9 square kilometers. And this is important because these lengths are different, right, along the coast. And so in order to compare the numbers of sharks we're seeing, we need to get a density. How many sharks per square kilometer are there? And if we have that, then we can compare among the different areas along the coast here. And so if you're looking at shark density, so in the wintertime, before the sharks get here, say your baseline data in December, you know, we're averaging maybe, what, maybe 0 to 1 shark per square kilometer. Okay, so not a huge number of animals. The most was off Boca, maybe 6 sharks per square kilometer. But you contrast that to peak season, February, when the sharks are here in numbers, and now the densities we're getting are off the scales. Now you're talking, you know, 1,200 sharks per square kilometer. It goes out here somewhere. You know, it actually goes off the screen. 1,200 sharks per square kilometer, 500 sharks per square kilometer. You know, huge numbers. And there's a dramatic dip right around from Boynton down to Miami here before you start to get more numbers down here. What's happening is these large numbers are from the sharks migrating north. These numbers are from the sharks coming down from the Keys and coming up. All right, and so these ones in the middle, we've got like this sort of no man's land where the density is relatively low in comparison to the peaks that we're seeing up in northern Palm Beach County here. And sort of to put this into perspective, you know, if I were to tell you, well, there's 1,200 sharks per square kilometer, well, that sounds like a lot, but what does that mean? I mean, you know, put this into something I can understand. So think of it this way. If you were snorkeling off the back of your boat, all right, there's some people snorkeling off the back of their boat having a good time, not realizing that there's a bunch of sharks literally right here. And on average, a density of 1,200 sharks per square kilometer means that you would find a shark about 16 meters away from you. So about 45 feet away, draw a circle from here to the wall and make a big circle around yourself like that. And somewhere in that circle, there's probably a shark. All right, that's the sort of density we're talking about. You go anywhere in Palm Beach County in the wintertime, and that's the numbers that we're talking about here. So with this in mind, we've got a lot of sharks. They're clearly here in the wintertime, hardly anything in the summertime, all right? And there's large numbers of them immediately adjacent to the shore. All right, so what we wanted to look at was why. Why are they here? What's the driver? You know, we're only seeing them for a brief period of a few months in the wintertime. What's going on? And so if we go back to these numbers again, these are the numbers of sharks that we're seeing, right? Huge numbers of sharks in the wintertime, drops off to hardly anything in the summer, and that's consistent across the board. And this one I did include in my 2019 data. And now if you overlay that with water temperature, and so you put water temperature on here, you can see that there's this strong inverse correlation. When shark numbers are high, that's when water temperature is low. When water temperature is high in the summertime, there's no sharks, right? So it's up and down. If one is up, one is down. Lots of sharks. Cold water, warm water, very few sharks. So you got this strong sort of inverse correlation with water temperature. And so temperature is clearly one of the drivers. And in fact, if you look at the water temperature here along your x-axis and the number of sharks, you only see the big numbers of sharks when the temperature is less than around 25 Celsius, so mid-70s or so. Okay? So they really don't like warmer water. They're here in the wintertime when the water's cool. But this leads to an interesting question, because if you look over the last decade that we've been doing this work, what do you think water temperature has been doing? Any guesses? Water temperature has been increasing significantly in the past decade. All right, and again, I don't have my 19 data on here, and I don't have 2020 yet, obviously. But it's the trend is significant. And you can say, well, it's, you know, 23.5 to 24.5. Is that really a big difference? Put it into perspective. The difference between a cold shower and a normal shower is about 1 degree, believe it or not, right? And so if you jump in and say, oh, that's way too cold, and you turn it up, you only have to increment it by about 1 degree Celsius for it to be comfortable for you, all right? That's the same sort of thing with these sharks. 1 degree doesn't seem like a lot, but it could have a really big impact, especially for these cold-bodied animals that don't have the ability to thermoregulate like us. So, since temperature has been creeping up over the past decade, What do you think the shark numbers have been doing? Going down, down, down. And if you look at peak abundance, it's been going down rather dramatically. This is that one year that they had that bee tree nourishment, so the number's really low that year. That's like that artifact. But in general, the trend is very clearly going down over time, to the point where the numbers that we used to have were close to 12,000 sharks at peak. Last year, we didn't even break 3,000. It's like a quarter of that. All right. So the numbers are down dramatically. This year, so far in 2020, we're not even at this level. We're down here. All right. We haven't even broken 2,000 yet this year. Hopefully that we've got a few weeks left. You know, hopefully I can get some cold weather coming down and bring some sharks down. But this is 2020 has so far been the worst year on record. So highly sensitive to temperature, but you know, this is just data from right here in the wintertime when they're in South Florida. That's not necessarily representative of their entire migration along the coast. We needed more data. We needed to see what these sharks were doing when they weren't here in Florida. What are they doing after they leave? And so that was the next iteration. What we started to do was instrument these sharks with satellite transmitters. Now, these satellite transmitters, I brought one here just to show you. This is what they are. You affix this to the dorsal fin of the shark, like this. You bolt it on with corrosible bolts, and so it stays on for about not quite a year, and then the bolts rust out and it falls off, and the shark is fine. And what happens is anytime the dorsal fin of that animal breaks the surface, the antenna talks to an orbiting satellite, and it gives you a GPS fix, and it gives you water temperature data that it's logged, okay? And so now, if you stick one of these transmitters on the shark, and as the shark is making its migration along the coast, this is one that we tagged in March of 2017, and you can see every dot there is when it communicated with the satellite. We're able to follow its movement along the coast until we lost it in June, but we're able to get the whole migration up along the coast there. Now, it's significant that we lost this guy right off Cape Hatteras, North Carolina here. And the reason is, if you look in the old scientific literature, the historic literature, for these black-tipped sharks, it states that their historic range goes from South Florida up to about Cape Hatteras, North Carolina. And it says that they go north of there only as an occasional rare stray. You know, one or two might occasionally go north of Hatteras, but that's it. What we found with our transmitter data is that the distribution has actually shifted dramatically in just the past few decades. Now, a significant number of our sharks, 43%, I believe, are going not just to Hatteras, but all the way up to Long Island, New York. They're going way farther. It's like 50% farther than they ever traveled before. And coming back again next year, we get them back again, right back here. And so what's interesting is these sharks are making a much longer migration. And if you look at the data that we're getting from the water temperature, you can see that the percent of time that they spend in the different temperatures is very tight. So they're spending 50% of their time in water between 22 and 23 C. Half their time is just in that narrow temperature band. 85% of their time is between 22 and 25, right? It's a huge percentage of their time in a very narrow temperature range. And they are following that preferred temperature from here in Florida. And as it gets too warm, it gets warmer up north, they keep going north, 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 north to stay within this preferred temperature range. And then as the water gets too cold up in New York in the fall, of course, it's too cold, and they start to move down, 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 back south here, always to stay within this narrow thermal preference for these sharks, okay? So there's this strong environmental cue, the strong temperature cue that really correlates with the abundance of these animals. And we're able to get some of this data from these satellite transmitters that we put on them, but these transmitters only give us a snapshot of what the temperature is right then and there. It doesn't give us an idea of what the sharks have been doing all along. And so for that, we've started to incorporate a new type of technology. This is a new project that I started with my student last year. And these are data loggers. That's my student, Ryan. And what we have here is this little device that is a data logger. It records temperature, but it also records the depth, the light level, the swimming velocity, three-axis acceleration, magnetic heading, and intensity. It records all of this data, and it sticks it in this tiny little package like this. This is one of these data loggers, one of these things, okay? All right, and it records all this data, and what happens is, after a little while, it pops off the animal, it floats to the surface, we go pick it up, we download all the data from here to get a really fine resolution, you know, detailed, I call it the daily diary. What have I been doing every day? Well, the shark tells us what it's been doing every day by giving us all this information. And it's just like your phone. Do you guys track the number of steps you take? You know, you walk along, you get your 10,000 steps today. This is telling us the same thing. Did the shark, you know, the three-axis acceleration, did the shark get in its 10,000 steps? How far did it go? How many tail beats did it do today? And so as we're doing this, it looks something like this. We bring the shark up beside the boat. We affix the little package onto the dorsal fin like this, take the hook out of the mouth, take the rope off the tail, let it go, and away it swims merrily on its way with this little package on it. And that's going to pop off in a little while. We'll go pick it up and see what it had done. Now, the neat thing is, when it's swimming like this, we can also watch it from above. This is that same animal, that same release. All right, we have a drone stationed overhead, and you'll see it. There, that's me with the hat with the stick videotaping. And as it swims away, the drone is able to watch it, and it's able to watch things like tailbeat frequency, you know, tip, tap, tip, tap, as the tail is moving back and forth. And we're able to watch it for a little while as it swims and see exactly if the data that are recorded in this data logger match what we're actually seeing in the animal as we're swimming here. All right, it's sort of like a ground truthing to make sure that what we're getting here is actually representative of what the animal is doing. And so this brings us to the next stage or the next phase of this, which is incorporating this drone technology. Now we're using these aerial drones to advance our information gathering capacity. They're useful because they're really cool. I mean, they're fun. You guys ever fly a drone? You know, they're really fun to fly. But because these sharks are so close to the beach, right, they're right there, we're able to go to the beach, launch our drone, fly it out over the animals, and get some really compelling footage. You're able to take the video footage that you get from the drone and see these schools of sharks. We're able to look at things like swimming velocity. We're able to look at how well they're spacing. You know, like, do they fly like birds that form nice little V formations? It turns out that they do. Are they in a nice polarized school, all swimming in the same direction? Are they all off doing their own thing? You know, we're able to get some, and what's the spacing between them? Are they all tightly packed? Are they all distributed? We're able to get some really good social information about the animals and the kinematics, the movements of the animals as they're swimming as well. And again, taking advantage of the fact that we have beautiful clear water down here in South Florida and lots of sharks in the shallow, clear water. So we're able to see this. The other reason we like drones is not only are we getting the actual data, the behavioral data, but we use them to cheat when we're fishing. You know, we have to catch the sharks to tag them. And if you fly a drone, you can see where are the sharks? And you can see, oh, they're over here. And then we motor our boat over there and then drop our lines in the water. So it helps us. It makes us efficient when it comes to our valuable time on the water trying to catch the animals in the first place. And again, oh, did that video not play? Just a second. Sorry about that. Yeah, there we go. Sorry about that. Again, you can see that, number one, these sharks are extremely close to the beach. I mean, they're right there. We have to come into the water that's like 3 to 4 feet deep to drop our lines because they're literally right up against the beach. But when we see where the sharks are, we're able to say, okay, this is great. Now we're going to drop our fishing gear here. And then we'll motor off somewhere else and drop our fishing gear there and take advantage of the fact that we have this bird's eye view. Again, this grew out of the fact that you can see so much from the air. All right. So this sort of stuff is useful, again, not only for, you know, storytelling, but also to help us capture the animals. Now, the other thing drone footage is useful for, and the other reason we use it, is it gives us an idea of what the natural history of the animals is. What are they actually doing? And we get some really good interactions that you might not be able to see if you were down at their level out on a boat. And so, for example, we know there's the thousands of these black tips and they're feeding on the little bait fish, but these black tips are also prey to even bigger sharks. And if you look, you also have big guys like this great hammerheads coming in to feed on these little black tips. All right? Again, this is sort of cool drone footage that's unobtrusive. The animals don't know you're there. They're going about their natural business. These black tips are totally oblivious to the fact that there's a huge hammerhead right behind them. And as it comes, look at how close he can get before the black tip notices, and then scooters away, oh, and everyone leaves. Poor hammerhead gets nothing. But he doesn't give up. He keeps chasing these guys down. So, and this isn't even trying. I mean, he didn't even burst or anything. He was just cruising along before they, the black tips bolted. But the interesting thing is, we're able to get these sort of observations now with drone tech that we were unable to see any time before. You could have never gotten this underwater, for example. This would have been really difficult to film from a boat. It'd be prohibitively expensive if you had to rent a helicopter to do this. Drones have really made it possible for us to really get an insight into some of the cool behaviors that these animals are doing. Now, watch as this black tip, as this hammerhead starts to get serious about these black tips. He's not kidding anymore. You'll see him change his swimming kinematics dramatically in just a second. Comes in, and as he swims along, the black tips are a little more wary now. They're not quite as lackadaisical as they could be. And then suddenly, boom, 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 boom. And the chase begins, all right? And he goes and he goes, and I'm not gonna show you the outcome. It might be too graphic. But I'll show you what happened afterward. Being out on the water is great because you get this sort of perspective. And if you're really lucky, you actually get to see natural predation in action. And this footage is stuff I collected last year. Whoops, pardon me. It should go like this, showing that. There's a great hammerhead with a black tip in his mouth. And you thought that hammerhead was big. Guess what? As we're driving along, another hammerhead pops up in frame, even bigger. This one goes to chase that one. That one drops his dead black tip at that point and bolts, and the big one goes to get it. I'm yelling to my student, Ryan, drive the boat, because I have the camera on a stick trying to aim in the general direction. Go forward, and I jammed it back in the water, and sure enough, he got it. He took it down head first. All that's left is the tail sticking out there, and even that disappears. And this guy got nothing for all his efforts, right? But you get an idea. Remember, these sharks, the black tips are about the same size as me, all right? These hammerheads are well able to swallow a black tip. They could easily take me if they wanted to, I'm sure. I'm in the boat, though, Again, I'm not an idiot. But you can see we've gone from these drones, which tell us really dramatic stories from the sky. But the underwater view is what sells it. When you see this, you see predation in action, you see, wow, this is cool. I want to see what's actually happening with these sharks underwater. One of the limitations is these black tips are so skittish. You can't jump in the water with them. They will bolt. I don't know if you've ever tried, but if you try to get in the water with these black tips, they're gone, all right? Go for it. It's not going to work. They're going to get out of the way. So we needed to come up with a way to film these black tips in an unobtrusive manner. Just like the drones, they don't know it's there. Drop something in the water so the sharks don't even know you're there. And so we came up with a simplest possible technique, what I call a block cam. It's literally a GoPro on a concrete block. That's all it is. You take a GoPro on a concrete block, you lower it down to the bottom with a float so you can get it again. And this way, anytime a shark swims by, it just is, as far as it's concerned, it's a rock sitting on the bottom. And you're able to get some really cool footage of these sharks in their natural habitat, not being disturbed by any humans or anything, and you're able to see what these sharks are doing in these large aggregations. And so a couple of the things to point out. Number one, this water's 6 feet at the most. It's shallow water, all right? It's not particularly deep. Again, this is close to the beach. These sharks are not bothered at all. They're just swimming along. Looking at the camera and just swimming away. They're not particularly concerned about it. And we can take advantage of the fact that from this video footage and from all the fishing that we've done, they're all males. They're male sharks. 100% of the sharks that we've caught here in the wintertime have been males. No females around. Females are apparently farther north. It's the males who make the trip all the way down here. this leads to the next question. What are we going to do about the females? Well, we have to go up north to tag the females. I mean, males and females get together for mating in the Carolinas in the summertime. And so females will give birth, and mating takes place in the shallow coastal estuaries in the Carolinas. And then, they go off and do their own little thing. And it turns out it's just the males who come all the way down here in the wintertime. I don't know why exactly. I have one hypothesis, which is highly offensive. But I'm going to tell you anyway. And you can tell me if you think it's wrong. Have you ever been walking beside a couple and the wife is pregnant and the husband isn't? And they're walking along, and what happens? The husband walks in front of the wife, and she's slow and waddling, right? He pulls away, and she keeps reprimanding him to wait up. He has to stop and wait for her to catch up. I think it might be something similar. These females are pregnant. They're migrating south for the winter. The males are not pregnant. They're migrating south for the winter. The males tend to pull a little bit farther ahead. They go farther south. The females just sort of give up and stay in Cape Canaveral or something. They don't even bother, right? They're not able to keep up. And so they might not. That might be why we're getting this sort of sexual segregation of the sharks along the coast. I don't have data yet. It's just an idea. I want to get data and demonstrate that I'm not being sexist. I think it might actually be a phenomenon. We'll find out. But just to wrap this sort of, bring this sort of together, I want to remind you that this started because people on the beach and sharks in the water led to a great deal of discussion and concern, consternation even, by people who were very curious about why there's so many sharks down here and should we be concerned about it. And I told people back then, a decade ago, the same thing I'm going to tell you now, sharks have been in the water for millennia. They've always been here. You were happily swimming in the water until you knew the sharks were there. I suggest that you're probably going to be pretty fine swimming in the water because these sharks are going to stay out of your way. We're fortunate down here in South Florida that we have such clear water. Because we have such nice clear water, the sharks are able to see. You're a big, clumsy human. You're not a little bait fish, right? And they're going to keep out of your way. It's much more of a problem if you go farther north. Go up to Lake New Smyrna area, Daytona area, right? Up there, the water is very turbid, very murky, and it's literally the shark bite capital of the world. You've got people in the water, turbid water, where the shark can't quite make out if that's a little bait fish or just the shiny palm of your hand in the water. And that's why people keep getting bitten up there and why we have relatively few bites down here where we have nice clear water. So I would encourage you, if you're here, you're probably, I didn't say you're guaranteed, you're probably going to be okay to go out swimming because the sharks are going to see you. They're going to stay out of your way. You're going to have a good time at the beach. The sharks are going to have a good time at the beach, and hopefully you never meet. But if you do, just recognize that you should consider yourself lucky. We have a lot of sharks here. We used to anyway. And it's indicative of a really healthy ecosystem. If you can support a good base of top-level predators, right, then that means you've got a lot of layers of bait fish and everything else underneath it to support that base. And so seeing lots of sharks, I view it as a positive. I encourage people to be excited when we have a lot of sharks down here. It means that we're doing something right. We have a good, healthy ecosystem to support them. If we lose the sharks, we don't know quite what the cascading effects might be throughout the whole ecosystem. It's important to have the top-level predators, and I think it's exciting that we have as many as we do. Well, I'm going to wrap it at that, and I'm going to acknowledge the Colgan Foundation that's funded our work for a number of years. They've been very generous in providing us, keeping us with tags and AVGAS. And I encourage you, if you're on Twitter or Instagram, follow us, at Shark Migration. And our Facebook page is FAU Shark Migration. And so with that, I'm going to bring the lights up, and I'm going to say thank you for the invitation and take any questions you might have. All right, any questions from the audience? Yes, sir, in the blue. Do you see Right. So when we're fishing, those big aggregations are black tips. There's no spinners, there's nothing else. It's just black tips. And we know that other species migrate. So for example, a colleague of mine tags white sharks off Massachusetts in the summertime. And we've detected some of his sharks down here on our receivers. And so we know that they're coming all the way down here as well and then going back north again. So we know other sharks are making these long distance migrations, but it's the black tips that are hugging the beach. They're the ones that are easy to see. They're the ones that engage the public's attention because they are so, you know, easy to see. And they're the ones that we've studied. So other sharks are probably migrating. We don't have enough information. We haven't tagged other species yet. So that's the next iteration. Yes, sir, in the white shirt. Water temperature has been increasing dramatically over the past decade, and shark numbers have been dropping dramatically in that time. And there's a very tight... They're simply not coming down. That's exactly right. So they're spending their summers off north, off Long Island, right? And then in the fall, as it starts to cool off, they start to go south to follow their preferred temperature. And when they reach their preferred temperature, they stop. And if that temperature happens to be in... Cape Canaveral, they stop there. If it happens to be off Fort Pierce, they stop there. If it happens to be off, Palm Beach, they stop there. And so since the water keeps getting warmer and warmer and warmer, those warmer temperatures are found at higher and higher latitudes, and they're simply not coming all the way down here in the huge numbers that we saw just a decade ago. Yeah, over here. Oh, you're right. I'm sorry. I forgot to repeat the question. The question was, when we're doing all this beach renourishment and you have all this turbid water, did we actually see more shark bites? That's a really good question. I don't think that we did. I don't have the data on me, but I didn't get any records. I didn't get any additional calls like I usually do during that time. So I don't know. I think I'd have to check with International Shark Attack File to see if their records indicated a spike at that time. Good question. That's exactly what you would expect, but I don't know that there was enough of an impact. Yes, sir, in the green. Right. So do the black tips ever go deeper, or are they just hanging out in the shallows? We're going to find out. The data that my student Ryan is collecting now with these data loggers, these things that he's putting on the fins, they will stay on for several days at a time, a week at a time, and that will tell us whether the sharks are maybe going deeper water at night and coming into the shallows during the day or what. We do know from some of the telemetry data that we have that these sharks go down to about 15 meters, 20 meters at the most. They don't spend very much time in the deep water, and they're mostly surface associated for the most part. Yes, sir, the orange. So the aerial survey data, we standardized it. It was always between 8 and 11 every morning, the same transect, same altitude, same airspeed, everything has been constant for a decade now. And so that enables us to compare across multiple years because it's the exact same methodology. I think I forgot to repeat the question again. All right, I'll try and remember, Dr. Zach. I'll try and remember. Yes, sir, in the green. Oh, yeah, so what are these sharks eating? There's literally tens of thousands of these sharks down here. We are currently examining that right now as well, taking advantage of these block cams. We've been dropping these block cams in the water at a fixed location, 50 meters from the beach, 100, 150, and 200, the same place every 2 weeks for the past year now, over a year now. And we're going back and we're looking at that video footage to count not only how many sharks are swimming by, but what bait fish are swimming by, lots of bluefish swimming by, for example. Maybe there's lots of mullets at certain times. And so we're getting an idea of when the bait fish are here in biggest numbers and what species are here, because that's going to help to inform us about what the prey base is for these sharks. So we're in the process of collecting those data now. I'll come back in another year, I'll let you know. All right? Yes, sir, right up front. That's a really good question. Are the sharks following temperature per se, or are they following the bait fish, which are triggered to temperature? it's going to be pretty much impossible to tease out which of those it really is. There's two things to keep in mind. One, based on our preliminary data of the bait fish that we've been looking at, bait fish abundance peaks in the fall, October, November. Sharks do not peak until February. So there's a significant offset between when the bait fish are here in abundance and when the sharks get here in abundance. That leads us to think that the sharks are not directly following the bait fish per se. And number two, getting to the root of the problem, everything is tied to temperature. You know, the primary productivity, you know, phytoplankton is tied to temperature, which feeds the zooplankton, which feeds the little fish, which feeds the bigger fish, et cetera, et cetera. All right? And so whether it's the whole, bottom-up production that's increasing and the sharks are following that, or whether it's temperature per se, I think it's going to be difficult to tease that apart. But we can use temperature as a proxy to say this is a clear, strong statistical correlation between temperature and shark abundance, and whether it's the temperature or whether it's some other temperature-driven factor, there's a clear correlation here, and that's what we're using. Good, very good distinction. Yes, sir, over here. Yeah, yes, sir. Coming down. Yeah. There's nothing there, right? You're not getting the sharks coming down and going farther down. You're getting your Keys population and South Florida population that's basically spilling over into Miami. Now, what's interesting is genetically, that population is distinct from the Atlantic population. You may be only separated by, 50 miles or 100 miles or whatever, but they are... The Gulf and Keys population is genetically separate from the Atlantic population, and they're just not mixing. It's just in that range between, maybe Miami up to Boynton, you got like a dead zone effectively of hardly anything there. Again, I forgot to repeat the question. All right. Yes, I'll repeat your question, I promise. How big were these hammerheads? Were they little babies?
I don't remember.
Oh, because... So she has seen large numbers of little hammerhead sharks just cruising around the docks right off Little Torch, which is very exciting because I have been wanting to find the nursery grounds for baby hammerhead sharks for a couple of decades now. If I can focus my attention around Little Torch Key, we might actually be successful. I'll try it, okay. Thank you for that. Yes? Oh, yeah. So the black tips are known to leap out of the water. And so the question is why? Why do they leap out of the water? I don't know. there have been a couple of different hypotheses that have been proposed. One is that it might have to do with removing parasites. So they've got little copepods that are stuck on their skin. If you jump, it's like scratching, right? They jump and they splash down and they smack these things off their body. That might be one explanation. Another explanation has been that it might be to promote group cohesion. It's like, I'm over here, I'm over here, I'm over here, and they sort of keep themselves together by popping out of the water. The third explanation might be some sort of dominance behavior. I'm the biggest male, I can jump the best, that sort of thing. Boom, splash, I make the biggest splash. None of these have been particularly rewarding explanations, but that's really all that's out there. That's all that people have proposed. I don't have a good explanation. I wish I had a better one, but I can only tell you what people have written over the years to explain it. If you have a better suggestion, I would love to hear, because I don't know. It is very cool. We have some cool high-speed video. There's another student, just an undergrad, who's doing exactly that, counting the numbers of spins. They spin 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, splash down into the water again. And we're interested in the the exit velocity. How quick do you have to go to launch yourself out of the water to go spinning in the air that much? And you know, when they're, it's not just barely skimming the surface. I mean, these things are up in the, you know, up in the air, you know, 5 feet in the air spinning around. So it's impressive. Yeah, right up front, sir. This is a very important distinction, is that black tips are spinners who spin, right? And the problem is they both do it, we think. The black tips do it for sure. The spinner sharks have long been called spinner sharks because they spin, although there's, if you really want to get down in the weeds, there's some debate about the initial description of spinner sharks spinning way back in the 40s, where they said they were spinner sharks spinning. That might not actually be right. Those might have been black tips in the first place. Anyway, putting that aside, we do know that black tips jump and spin. Spinners, probably, you know, they're so similar in so many ways that I wouldn't be surprised if they did. Yeah, in the green. Right. Generally, these sharks, the migration, the question is, when does the migration start and end down here in South Florida? These sharks start to arrive down here around late January, typically. And they will leave by around the first part of April. All right, you have peak abundance in February, around end of February. But it's highly variable. 1 year we had a very cold snap early, and we had a lot of sharks in, you know, end of January. Other years, was it 18 or whatever it was a really late year. We didn't have big numbers of sharks until, you know, toward the latter half of March, you know, because the water just stayed warm for a long time until we had a cold snap. So it's highly variable, but generally I tell people February is your peak. You know, it's from end of January till the end of end of March basically is the time down here. Yes, sir. Yeah. The point is snowbirds, and sharks are snowbirds too, right? They come from New York, Long Island in the summertime, down to Florida in the wintertime, go back north again. It's exactly what they are. Yes, sir. Right, so is the shark population increasing? Even though we see fewer sharks here, this is a mere snapshot of one area. What we do have data on is the fisheries catch of these black tips. Now, black tips are a commercially important species. You can go to public supermarket and buy a black tip, right? They sell it. Some people eat them. It's the second most popular shark after sandbar shark. And so there's a National Marine Fisheries manages the fishery for the blacktip sharks. And so the blacktip population as a whole is robust. It's doing okay. The fact that we're seeing fewer sharks down here doesn't mean that the population is crashing. It just means that they're simply not, they're not coming quite as far south. It's an important distinction. Yeah. As we eat everything else? Sure. So the question is, are we going to be looking to sharks as a food fish going forward? There was a move back in the 1980s where the federal government stimulated fishing for sharks, saying this is an underutilized resource. Let's start fishing them. But the problem was they were being exploited at a rate that was too high for the sharks to keep up. And the shark populations crashed very dramatically after like 5 years in the 1980s. And so we're still, 30 years later, still recovering from that. Sharks can be fished commercially and utilized if it's done well and carefully managed. But the problem is there's much better sources of food out there. Things like black tips, they're loaded with mercury, right? So there's a lot of heavy metal accumulation in these top-level predators. And so you could eat them if you wanted to, but I don't recommend it, right? And so There's some markets are really looking to that, but I don't think it's going to be a long-term sustainable or large-scale component of our diet going forward. Yeah. There was someone over here I thought had, yeah. You know, yeah, sadly, the sampling that we've done ends in Jupiter, and do we have anything beyond that, farther north? Unfortunately, I don't. And the reason is I have to stop somewhere. And Jupiter Inlet seemed like a natural sort of place to stop because it was the end of Palm Beach County. And as you get farther north, it actually becomes a little more difficult because the water does become more turbid. You contrast, you know, I live in Boca Raton and we have beautiful, clear water a lot of the time. And you contrast that with, you know, a little bit farther north here, the water is not quite as crystal clear quite as often. And so flying an aerial survey, it becomes increasingly difficult to be able to see down into the water. And that's why we're not not expanding our survey much farther north. Yes, sir?
Do they tend to aggregate?
So the question is, do they aggregate around the inlets more? And from what we've seen, no. You would have thought that would have been the case because you have a lot of outflow, freshwater outflow, a lot of little bait fish in the area. But the large aggregations that we're seeing are not associated with the inlets.
And are they live bearers?
Yes. Are they live bearers? These sharks are live bearers. The females will give birth to about, on average, about four pups per year. And they birth in like these shallow coastal estuaries and, you know, from Georgia up through the Carolinas. Females will give birth, and then the females take a year off. They don't reproduce for a year, and then they will gestate for about 11 months. So they pregnant 1 year, take a year off. Pregnant 1 year, take a year off, sort of deal. All right? Just a couple more questions. Yeah? So, yeah, do the females and males separate due to predation? One of the ideas is that the females are going into these shallow habitats to give birth to prevent the bigger sharks from eating little babies, right? And that makes sense. You want to get your little, your vulnerable offspring into a sheltered habitat away from the bigger sharks, like the bigger males or whoever, who might be preying on them. It's very likely the case. You know, we can't say definitively, but it makes perfect sense that they're dropping pups in an area where they're not going to be eaten.
Right? Actually,
the
question, I wasn't trying to cut you off.
Oh.
So, male sharks, tens of thousands of male sharks, right? And
right. 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 So is this sort of sexual segregation that we're seeing where you have all male groups, is that unique to these black-tipped sharks? And the answer is no. We see that in a bunch of other sharks as well. I can't speak to a lot of other fish species. I simply don't know. I'm a shark guy. But I can say that you do see this a lot with sharks and their relatives where you have large groups of just males or just females. And so... you know, it's a common phenomenon. I haven't seen it spatially segregated like this along a coastline, along a latitudinal gradient like this. So that might be a function of their migration, but I simply don't know. And I think it might be that the females, like you were suggesting, may not be as sensitive to the temperature. They can tolerate the cooler or the broader range of temperatures that the males might simply be unable or unwilling to tolerate. Right. One last question, sir. I would love to have a better plane. All right.
We need a bigger boat. He's making a Jaws joke.
Very good. Well, thank you, everyone, for the invitation. I appreciate it.